All right, so guys, let's start. Let's start about how to do the synthesis in non-stationary speed synthesis, right? So the presentation's outline is this. First of all, we're going to give a short history of vocoding. We're going to focus then on vocoders for TTS. We're going to discuss about synthesis, about quality, and about our system. Then we're going to discuss a little bit about the speech signal, which was mostly covered by Yannis. I'm going to give my perspective as well. And then we're going to go into the main part, which is the Vocaine, give an overview, present a model of speech, actually, because that's what it is. There's an underlying model of the speech waveform. So what is this? And then discuss about pitch synchronous framing, spectral sampling, then deterministic stochastic model, and then some special sort of splines that I use to synthesize. Then how to synthesize sounds that are not exactly aperiodic and not exactly periodic, like voice fricatives, using a coherent noise modulation model. And then we're going to talk about how to do fast synthesis sinusoidal. Yes. So I kind of found all these publications here where you can see that vocoders, actually, models of the speech signal, they have been very, they started up to from the 1791, from Wolfgang here. That was actually a kind of vocoder where the vocal tract was made out of leather, was a tube made out of leather. You could put your hand inside, squeeze it a little bit in several locations, and then you may be able to fit exactly the location of an A, and then you pass in the air and synthesize the A. Then going down to euphonia in 1846, mechanical talker in 1937, the electrical era found us with Voder from Bell Labs, and then with Fant, you all know him, from 1950s in Sweden, where he had a two-formant plot here, F1, F2, and he was able to move it around, that he was synthesizing with artificial resonances, some vowels. And then in the computer era, we had effectively, the main application was speech coding for military purposes, where you have an ultra low bit rate or a very low bit rate, depends how you see it, in 2.4 kilobits per second from the LPC-10. Multiband excitation vocoder, which you all know the modern version of it, which is straight, and sinusoidal transform codec, which is a split band sinusoidal excitation vocoder, multiband excitation vocoder. Then, in the speech synthesis time, there was very new interest when unit selection was very hot in the early 90s, where Yannis tried to use his harmonic plus noise model in Bell Labs to synthesize units effectively. His goal was to be able to do pitch modifications in very high quality in voice morphing. When statistical parametric speech synthesis came, most people started using straight because it was available and it was very high quality as well. And then later on in 2013, Aero also open sourced, at least an executable. He gave his implementation of harmonic plus noise model, which is also available if you guys want to try it out. So, what is a vocoder from the TTS synthesis perspective, right? So, it is an analysis synthesis algorithm. Vocoders are tools we use to parameterize the speech signal in a way that it is statistically amenable to coding. It is amenable for coding and statistical manipulation. So, we want to have an acoustic space of the speech signal that we can treat with any model, and that's why we use a vocoder for. We take the speech signal, we do the analysis, and we assume some acoustic parameters. The typical pipeline that we use in statistical parametric speech synthesis is that we go from the text, we extract some linguistic features, some parameters of the text that describe the text itself. Then we use statistical mapping that map these features into some PDFs, and then from the PDFs we extract one realization, one sequence, one trajectory of the acoustic parameters that later on we apply a post-filtering mechanism to enhance somehow, and we do vocoding. In many cases, you will see that these two steps have been done simultaneously using an LSTM. But conceptually, that's a very good separation because it delineates the difference between capturing a conditional PDF of the acoustics, given the linguistics, where here's the linguistics, here's the acoustics, and out of all possible realizations that follow this PDF, picking up one. So, you can use any method you like. The best methods are the LSTMs right now. And SynSIG has made a bunch of work on it. It's actually, I think, pioneered the field. So, what is a vocoder? What is the purpose of a vocoder in text-to-speech synthesis, in a text-to-speech system? It is effectively we're trying to replace the mechanics of the speech synthesis. If you see the neural network here as capturing the relationship between text and acoustic parameters, the vocoder is the part that replaces here all the vocal system. So it's conceptually, it has a different job. When you want to utter some speech, then you have some sort of internal representation of knowledge, some sort of intention, some sort of content, some sort of context as well. And then you are sending the messages to your vocal system, and your vocal system, with whatever is available, tries to pass the message to convert it to speech. And this mechanism, as Yannis noted at the beginning, has been trained from very early age. Because you hear yourself, and then you have mirroring, neural mirroring mechanism that go back and have a feed, there's a feedback mechanism that allows you to be able to use your vocal system to utter almost any possible sound that we find in speech. We evaluated TS quality and vocoder quality using an MOS naturalness scale. There are many ways of evaluation. This is one we use because we mainly want to capture the way that people feel that they talk to an actual human. So naturalness is one of the criteria that is very important for us. And the scale goes from 2 to 5, with 2 being poor and 5 being excellent. And 2 means mostly an unnatural speech. 3 means equally natural and unnatural speech, mostly natural speech, and completely natural speech. The quality below 2.9 is almost unmarketable here. You wouldn't like to hear to such a synthesizer. You wouldn't like to use it. No matter what, you'll find another way of doing your job. The quality above 4.5, I call it imaginary quality because if the test is well constructed and is well calibrated and everything, you should not be seeing these numbers. We get fluctuations around it for up to 4.6 and or 4.2, depending on how the human human articulates speech as well. Whether it even correlates to how pleasant speech is. You ask a question about naturalness, and also you get an opinion about the actual voice, the quality and the pleasantness of the voice, the recording. His quality here, there's a saturation effect, has to do with the fact that we have a scale and with fixed points, and people, when they ask to vote between 4 and 5, the maximum they can give is 4.5. You see the same thing in the stars, in the restaurant, when you do ratings. Many times you see 4.5 as a rating, especially when you have many, many samples, and the guy doesn't tweak his ratings. So the same saturation effect happens here as well. This is audio field quality, this is telephony quality, the one we used when we do communication with our mobiles. And before Vocaine, that's where we were, we had statistical systems that were kind of entering the unmarketable quality era. Do you hear me back there? Now you hear me back there. Do you consistently hear me back there? I'll take that as a no. So the unit selection system were rated around 3.7 and 3.8, and we clearly had to do something particularly for this domain. In terms of Google, we use the statistical synthesizers for embedded synthesis whenever the mobile is not capable of being connected to the internet with a high speed, sufficiently high speed. So it's a backfall. We also have to use it definitely for accessibility purposes because we have to utter very fast speeds, ultra fast, and people depend a lot on the latency as well. So the Android TDS quality was 3.2, the before Vocaine, and the embedded was about 3.5. A best vocoder that we could ship in a product, it was fast enough, it was 3.5. The the best vocoder we had was 3.7. And then clearly we had to, and this was the upper bound of quality in the statistical synthesis, right? You can't get better than your vocoder when you are doing statistical synthesis if you're sufficiently high. So, are you sure you don't need a better vocoder? Well, I guess we do. That's what we saw right now. And when we started, there was a 0.5 MOS gap between the current and the state of the art. So this gap here of 0.5 MOS is really huge. And we use it in a bunch of applications. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about a little bit about the speech signal now. When we are doing waveform modeling, especially for the speech signal, we incorporate inside our models implicit or explicit assumptions. So we may pick up principles from essentially the speech production system, from models that we know, like the source filter, about how speech production occurs, or we may pick up principles from the ear, from auditory models. So there's an interplay there. These are that's what I call the two pillars. There's two sources of justification for picking up any design choice of any waveform modeling algorithm. Once you are based on these two, you are going well. So one of the, for example, of the principles we use is from the ear is the Mel scale. We model Mel septum, right? This principle originates from the fact that the ear responds in a scale that is more related to Mel. And also amplitude compression also is related to how the ear listens. And phase coherence is also related to modulation detectors inside the ear. So mouth, we use the concept of vocal tract, we use the concept of nasal tract, aspiration, we know about glottal excitation, you've seen this all over there. So when you construct a vocoder, you are picking up ideas from here, here and there, you're trying to put them in one set that has high quality. In there's three ways of seeing the speech signal. I call them dichotomies in the sense that they guide our perception of what the speech signal is. The first is a source filter dichotomy, where that originates from the vocal, from the speech production. So where we presume this periodic, of course, and then we have a vocal tract, and then we have a radiation impedance, and then we get a sampling of the spectrum at the harmonic frequencies here, and a vocal tract. We sample the vocal tract at the harmonic frequencies. Already Yannis talked about, so I'm not going to stick a little bit more. Then we have other dichotomies like deterministic and stochastic. We discussed about recovering sinusoids, but what about recovering which parts of the signal are noise, like in a voice fricative, which parts of the signal are deterministic, are not noise. In straight terminology, we have the spectral envelope like this, and we have an aperiodicity envelope. And the difference between the two is like a signal-to-noise ratio. for every band, for every frequency. So if you're familiar with straight, then you see that this difference here is the amount of noise you have, effectively, between your harmonic and where the noise level starts. This is the noise level, this is the harmonic, at this location here. And why do we use this sort of per band noise aperiodicity or a non-deterministic model? Because we have a lot of phenomena that happen there, like aspiration, we have frication that happens on constrictions, we have voice fricatives as well. We have the fact that the vocal folds do not close completely in many cases. So you have incomplete closures of the vocal folds, which means that as they're like this, air passes through. Another very famous dichotomy that people inherit their mind is from FFT, comes from FFT, which is the amplitude and phase. When you are talking in terms of amplitude and phase, you're effectively talking in terms of FFT, right? Amplitude and phase are constructs of the FFT effectively, almost. So if we see from this perspective, then we can say that the speech signal is also an amplitude and a phase. And the sum of modulated cosines. You've seen this model already, you talked quite a lot. And there's a question there. How do you construct a good, if you have only the amplitude, what is a good model for the phase? And this is one of the questions that Vocaine answers to a certain extent. So the overview of Vocaine is this. Functional overview is that it has high spectral resolution. So you can, when you have some parameters and then you're synthesizing back the original signal, then the parameters you are getting are very close to what you already, what you expect, what you gave into the input signal. Because the process of synthesis, for example, overlap add itself, does not guarantee that you'd have exactly the amplitude, the instantaneous amplitude and the instantaneous frequency that you gave for synthesis. There's no complexity penalty for the high resolution. We have a decoupling between the spectral parameterization and the DSP implementation. Many of you guys that have already synthesized using, for example, a filter for Melkep, right? Or LSPs, or whatever spectral envelope or model that you may have used, you see that there's a restriction between the synthesis method, there's a relation between the synthesis method and the actual parameterization of the spectral envelope. Vocaine breaks this. You may have Melkep, you may have LSP, you are not forced to synthesize using an autoregressive model or to synthesize using a Mel filter and so on. So this decoupling allows you to explore parameterization, which we never really found some better parameterization, but allows you at least to explore which is the best parameterization for whatever you're trying to do. And then you have an asynchronous phase model. The asynchronous phase model is quite interesting because it allows you to blend vocoded speech with recorded speech. So if you want to do a statistical unit and you want to have actual chunks of audio, and then in the middle put a chunk of audio that is synthesized artificially from a model, then you want to make sure that you don't have huge phase mismatches. And this asynchronous phase model allows you to do this. Of course, it goes ultra-wideband and whatever, up to 48 kilohertz, and it's a universal decoder, in a sense, effectively. Because you can use whatever model. You can use Yannis, H&M, adaptive quasi-harmonic model, straight, multiband excitation. Whatever you want to synthesize, you can get it back. So think of it as a synthesis algorithm. High quality, compares to straight, can beat it, yes, in a fair experiment. Low computational complexity, yes. Single structure, multiple data, friendly. I already did that, so yes. And it's very simple. So that's very good for maintenance, especially when you have engineers together, software engineers, software engineers, together with researchers working, you want people to be able to navigate through your code. All right, so the speech model of Vocaine is effectively one equation. Describe the whole speech signal in one equation. You don't have different ways of synthesizing, let's say, the noise and the deterministic part, and then gluing them together somehow, and then dealing with how we have spill-off of noise from the harmonics to the non-harmonics, from the noise to the non-noise, and so on. You don't have any of these problems because it is it's described in this equation here. This is the cosine, right? So you've seen this. This is the phase. So we'll talk about it. How do we construct a nice phase? Because the whole trick is here, how to generate the noise. There's a trick that we do. And the trick is exactly on these phases. Then this is a model for voice fricatives. We're going to talk about it. And this is the instantaneous amplitude of the kth harmonic. So, and this is the first harmonic. So all the harmonics, except the first, they're described by this part here. And the first harmonic, if you notice, the phase of the first harmonic here, it is used to modulate the rest of the signal. So if you remember the, what Yannis showed you about the time envelope of the noise in speech, the time envelope of the noise speech exhibited a particular pitch synchronous behavior. So as the pitch marks over like this, the glottal closure instance, then there was noise, 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 was fall, and the time envelope was in this fall. Vocaine does it explicitly by taking the first harmonic and just, it's a model of the time behavior of the aspirated component, aspiration components, the non-periodic components in speech. Let's talk about pitch synchronous framing. So we've seen the equation. We know now that there's a little bit of this bit here, we don't know exactly, we haven't gone into depth into several components, but the most important part to understand at this stage is how we do the asynchronous, the pitch synchronous framing, the asynchronous pitch model, as I call it. So the, in Vocaine, there's no difference between a voiced speech and unvoiced speech, right? They all synthesize with exactly the same functions. And also, what happens here is that, so there's a common concept of what I call a reference synthesis instinct, which in voice pitch, they are the glottal closure instance. In unvoiced pitch, they are the pitch marks, which are regularly placed every 10 milliseconds. Whenever we start at time zero, we start from here, and we want to synthesize one pitch period, it might be voiced, it might be unvoiced. These are RSI, reference synthesis instance. They are not glottal closure instance. We compute the pitch period, or the synthesis period, to be more exact. We compute the synthesis period, and we say this is the frame where I'm expecting the parameters at the end. So I'm expecting the parameters here. I know the parameters of speech at the beginning. I know the parameters of speech at the end. And I'm interpolating between frames 2 and 3. And I synthesize this pitch period completely independently of the previous one and the next one, as long as I keep here some continuity smoothness constraints. And then I do, once I synthesize this pitch period, I know this frame and where it goes in T1, I can add the next pitch period, synthesis period, or synthesis period if it's unvoiced, and then I go to frame 7. So Vocaine tends to throw away all these frames, and it does not impact quality, except for the case of super fast speech. In this case, it uses them, but it makes the presentation much more complicated, so I will skip it. So, so now we can presume that we are talking about synthesis of one very, very particular case. We have the beginning, of a pitch period. We have the end of the pitch period, and we have the parameters at the beginning of the pitch period. We have the parameters at the end of the pitch period, and we want to synthesize what is in the middle. What we have to do is to sample our spectral parameterization, our spectral envelope, on the location of the harmonics. So we have a spectral envelope, which I showed you something like this. And then we have the harmonics here, 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 here. And we want to sample them. It is very easy and very cheap computationally. That's why we use it in the MelCap domain. And you can also do it in LSP domain directly using this formula, if you like. I have the reference inside the paper. But in general, you don't have to tie up your spectral parameterization to the signal processing that is used for synthesis. You could just give FFT. And in fact, Pallavi there is doing it. So you have a FFT, log spectra, you just give it whatever you curve you can construct, you can sample it. And then we have the phase. So we discussed about how to recover the amplitudes at the beginning and at the end of the synthesis period, which might be a pitch period, might be completely unvoiced. How do we construct the phase so that we construct simultaneously the deterministic behavior and the stochastic behavior of the phase? Because you may be, for example, at 8 kilohertz was completely noise. You may have a completely noisy harmonic. Or you may want to synthesize, as we said, an unvoiced part of speech. There you have to put some phase there that generates noise. Traditionally, what we do is that we put random phases. So it's pretty clear what we do, but it's quite clear what we do in completely unperiodic speech, in noisy speech. But what we do in deterministic speech is also very clear. What is not clear is what we do in the in-between cases where we have the signal-to-noise ratio to give here of, let's say, 10 dB. So at this location here, in particular, we want the periodic part of this harmonic, the periodic part of speech here of the signal, to be 10 dB higher, let's say. That's actually more, it's like 30. To be 30 dB higher than the noise level. And this has to be done by synthesizing one deterministic component. And that's what I'm going to show you how I do it. So now we'll talk about the stochastic part, right? So we get the explicitly provided phases from a phase envelope. So you may have a phase envelope that is, you have trained externally somehow. You may have constructed your phase envelope using anyway. Or you may give a fixed one. Vocaine uses a fixed one so that it doesn't have to worry a lot about, mainly because of speed. But I have used minimum phase, maximum phase, mixed phase. You can use whatever. Another thing that matters here, and the unvoiced spectra here are, in the phase of the unvoiced spectra, are uniformly distributed between minus pi to pi, or 0 to pi. So between these two points, when you want to synthesize completely unvoiced speech, it's very easy. The voice peak spectra now is a sum of signs excitation with some phase dispersion. I'm going to say exactly how this happens. Now, let's presume that you want to synthesize a pulse, right? That is a sum of signs pulse with phase dispersion, where you have the first harmonic is completely coherent with the reference synthesis system, which means that if you have the reference synthesis systems at this location, the first harmonic will go like this. And then the rest of the harmonics are offsetted by 2 pi and a uniform distribution, plus minus 4. This means that the phases, and this is the deterministic phase spectra. This is fixed. We compute it once at the beginning of the utterance, and we keep it all the way. Once we want to synthesize speech with a particular periodicity, we multiply the noise effectively, the level of the noise inside the phase. So we add noise to the phase itself by the function of the aperiodicity. So which means that if the speech is completely aperiodic, yes.
Diagram there, so
it's like
first
time of the theorem. Yeah, the mistake. You're right. Yes. It is true. So the at phase when the aperiodicity f zero, a function of the periodicity is zero, then this phase fk becomes ck. Becomes a deterministic. When a periodicity is 1, which means totally aperiodic, then this phase component dominates over this one. So we have the more aperiodic our signal is, the more noisy the phase at the harmonic is. So instead of adding noise, yes.
So the voice phase spectra is constant.
No, so the voice, yes. So the phi here, you mean, right? The phi. First of all, this one is the one that comes out of our phase model. We somehow have, it may be sampled from the signal itself. We may have a signal, the waveform, we may compute a phase envelope somehow, there's ways to do that. And then you want to add to this phase as much noise as a periodic your component is. So if your component here is completely aperiodic, is completely deterministic, because deterministic is better than periodic, then you would like to keep only this. You would like to be only that, right? If it is noisy, then as much, if you would like to make it as noisy as possible, so you add this component here. Right? This gives you a way of introducing aperiodicity, without affecting the amplitude of the harmonic. So you add noise without touching the amplitude of the harmonic. The instantaneous amplitude of the harmonic is what you intended. That's why I call it high resolution. Nope. How do I do that now? So in the quadrat, and so we see now the following things. We're seeing instantaneous amplitude at the beginning of a harmonic, instantaneous amplitude at the end of the harmonic. We've seen ways to compute the phase of the harmonic at the beginning. We saw ways to compute the phase of the harmonic at the end. And we're looking for a way to construct the signal. For the amplitude, we can do a simple linear interpolation, so that's easy. But for the phases, it's not as easy as it seems. And the cubic phase model that Yannis described, the model from Quartieri, described in the previous slides, is not going to give us a structured way of making, of breaking the harmonicity of the signal. So that is the key point. The cubic phase model, which was something like, I just don't know how to do that. Yes. It's all right. I'll talk about it. Okay. So the cubic phase model was of this form. Yeah. So what it didn't do is that it didn't give you it, it. You were given some amplitude at the beginning, at the end, and then it could go any way that decide to do as long as it was qubit. But you didn't. You had no way of controlling how harmonic are the components within here if you take it across many different harmonics. So if you have many harmonics, the first, the second, the third harmonic, you may have taken all the difference, all the change in this bit, in this part, or you may have taken all the modification in this part. And this is something that introduces glitches from time to time. So I needed a different model in order to be able to synthesize noise with that. And that was the cubic model, that I, the quadratic phase splines. So, in the quadratic phase splines, the synthesis period is split into two halves. The first half there and the second half. First half that goes up to here, this bit, and the second half here. And it corresponds to a piecewise linear frequency model. So we have a piecewise linear frequency model that goes up to omega zero is piecewise linear. And then we have a mid period, we have a continuity at the center of the pitch period, which is chosen to maximize smoothness. And it's very fast as well. So effectively what we do is that this is phase. We have this model for the first half and this model for the second half. So as you can see, this is phase. Right? So the derivative of this is the instantaneous frequency. This is instantaneous phase at time n, and instantaneous frequency is omega k, s plus gamma 2 gamma k, s multiplied by n. So from the beginning to the middle of the pitch period, we have a linear function and then another linear function, one line to another line. And we have a phase unwrapping integer here, which tells us how many times we have done the pitch, how many multiples of p, how many times we have gone around the unit circle. In the sinusoid. If we solve this now quadratic phase splines, in order to obtain the parameters, we have to solve this linear system with seven constraints. Remember, we have instantaneous amplitude, we have the phase at the beginning of the pitch period, we have the frequency at the beginning of the pitch period, right? We have the phase at the end of the pitch period. We have the frequency at the end of the pitch period. We have one smoothness constraint that we have continuity at the middle of the pitch period at NC. We have a continuity both in phase and in frequency. So this phase continuity is frequency continuity at the middle of the pitch period. And then we have a smoothness constraint that tells us that the curve we want to reconstruct is maximally smooth, which means it's the integral of the double derivative of phase, the square of it, is minimized. And by minimizing this term, we effectively get back the 2 pi multiple. So we started from how many unknowns? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 unknowns. We made seven equations and we can solve for the phase, for the quadratic phase line. This is an example of it. This is a pitch period or actually a synthesis period that goes from 0 to 160 samples here. And you can see that, and we added several levels of noise. So if we have no noise, you can see that it goes straight. This is the frequency, right? It's not phase, this frequency. And this is the phase of the same curves. So it's linear phase here, which means fixed frequency. If we add noise, then the endpoint frequencies remain the same at 100, but the midpoint frequency goes to 125. So effectively, the more noise we add at the phase, at the harmonic, the more the sender frequency, the frequency at the center of the pitch period, deviates from the frequencies of the at the endpoints. So you start with a frequency that is, you start from a value here. Oop, doesn't work. Of, let's say, 100, and then enter the value of 100, and this epsilon here, this delta, is related to your level of noise, to a periodicity. This is omega k at the end, this is omega k at the beginning, and the omega k at the middle, right, is related to omega k at the end, a comma at the beginning, and to the aperiodicity. So what do you do with that? You break harmonicity. The signal becomes more and more non-harmonic. So that's how you generate noise, by not having an effective noise model. You have a stationary a set of sinusoids, and then you can construct noise with it. And this is here how to it effectively gives you these advantages. The sinusoidal tracks are not harmonically related. This is a natural way to control a periodicity, right? In the sense, because you don't have to, you can correlate it directly to the signal noise ratio. Sinusoids are guaranteed to be harmonic only at the pitch mark, at the end points of SP synthesis. So if you have, let's say, discontinuities, all these discontinuities will be located in particular location inside the pitch period. And harmonicity breaks according to the noise level. So we discussed about instantaneous amplitudes, this and this, linear interpolation, instantaneous phase, quadratic phase models. And now we're going to discuss about this term here, which is the coherent noise modulation term. This is nothing more than a way to shape the noise according to the aspiration pattern of the noise that Yannis presented you in the previous slides. And it makes sense only for, it makes sense in voice fricatives and in the higher frequencies of the vowels, because you don't want it to be very buzzy. What does it do, effectively, this term? Check it out a little bit closer. It has a fixed term, gamma zero, here, and then it has the periodicity multiplied by the first, the cosine that is actually of the first harmonic. So if they have a periodicity equal to zero, then it's a fixed term, it doesn't do anything. If a periodicity is equal to one, then it becomes like this signal here, where it has this behavior around one. So if you modulate your signal like this, this is your harmonic, right? And as we saw, this is the sinusoid, and the sinusoid can synthesize noise itself. Then this term here modulates this sinusoid with this time envelope and concentrates noise in around the glottal closure distance. This is in time domain. In frequency domain, it takes energy from the sender of the harmonic and just spreads it around. Because that's what happens when you multiply cosine with the signal, that takes it and puts it minus, plus minus the sender frequency. And the question is, well, does it work? The French language is particularly rich in voice fricatives. Qu'est-ce que vous voulez, for example, or vas-y, vas-y. We had a great improvement there, as you're going to see from the results. And here are some references. Well, of course, there's Yannis, Siliano work here, Macri as well, who is one of the first guys that proposed this, Bastian Klein, of course, he did a listening test to show how time frequency masking happens on noise, because that's what we're trying to do effectively. We're trying to mask the noise to incorporate into the speech signal with the phase mode, with the time envelope, this one. And then I used it also in my LF plus noise vocoder. So this experimental result with several parameters. I'm not going to go through the details because I only have 5 minutes. What I want to say is this, that in terms of computational complexity, it is almost as fast, it's exactly as fast as the previous implementation of mixed band excitation, which was was quite optimized as well. Then, when we did a listening test for English, this is the MOS of the recorded speech. We're talking about clean database now. Noise database could have a different. This is Vocaine synthesis with straight analysis. And this is what Vocaine synthesis with our version of straight got. Because straight is patented, so we can't use it. We have our own implementation of something similar to straight. So we got this number, the actual implementation of straight got this number here when we're using Vocaine synthesis. This straight version produced this MOS here, 4.07. So you can see we match the quality of straight while being very, very fast able to go and to put our method into the small devices. But we also got something much better when we combined the merits of straight analysis with Vocaine. And this is where we are in the scale. And this, all this is for English. When we go to French, then we see a great improvement. We see that straight goes around to 4.016, while the same type of analysis with straight synthesis goes to 4.265. Why? Because of the voice fricative model. Our previous analysis was, embedded analysis was getting numbers like this one, 3.3 in French, because it was not capable of dealing completely with voice fricatives. And now we are in 4.3. That's the version you are using whenever you are using your mobile. The overall summary is that the original speech MOS gets about 4.5. Straight with Vocaine gets at 4.2. Straight alone gets 4.05. Coder, our own previous vocoder, our own vocoder analysis gets 4.05 if we use it with Vocaine. Coder with the previous two vocoders gets 3.7, 3.5. So effectively, we got improvement of 0.5, 0.75 MOS in the server synthesizer, in the embedded synthesizer 0.7 to 1. So these are quite huge improvements. Let's have 5 minutes. Now I did another experiment that's quite interesting because it has in the same experiment uniselection systems, parametric systems, and copy synthesis with vocoding and recorded speech. So it's kind of puts in the, if you put them all in the same listening test, you get an idea of how relative the distortions are, what is important. For example, what distortion is important when you have uniselection, what distortion is important when you have, how important is the degradation coming from vocoding related to the degradations coming from speech synthesis. So in here you see that our use selection systems, two of them, two different technologies. That's a first generation, that's a second generation. It's a 3.788, right? So they all yield around the same 3.8, let's say, MOS. Copy synthesis with spray goes to 4.90, and copy zero with our own analysis and Vocaine goes to 4.176. And if we put straight analysis, it goes to 4.337. But effectively, this tells you is that when you want to compare how much, where you are getting degradation from when you are doing speech synthesis, the vocoder itself is not the primary source of degradation. There are much more significant things that you have to cater for. And all the parametric synthesizers are here. So you can see that this here, Vocaine plasmid excitation, an LSTM synthesizer that Hega make the LSTM, was 3.738, right? So we pretty much went close to the unit selection. And the question was, the same thing happened from friends. I'm going to skip it. And I'm going to go to what happened if you then... Okay, we saw that we have a statistical system that goes very close to the unit selection. But how close can you get? Can you beat the unit selection? To what extent, right? And what we got is that for US English, right, the unit selection system is much better than three different versions of statistical systems that we have here in blue. So we have an embedded one and two non-embedding configurations. And this one got much better. Why? Because English, American English, is a language that Google has really invested in and wants to make it sound very good. At the same time, for Spanish, the difference is smaller because we haven't invested that much time. And the same image, if we take all the European languages, you see that some of them, actually, you have a small difference improvement over here.
When you say not that much time, do you mean not that much data?
When I say not much time is that there's both data and cleaning the data and actually how many people you put, how much effort you put to fix the unit selection system, because unit selection system effectively goes down to getting to every single way from fixing bugs, yes.
Evaluations are like one step, just in one speaker or one voice, or one voice.
All these values are made in one voice with one, yes, a single speaker.
Always female or male?
Always female, because people want to hear female voices, and it's sad, but all the results I present are female only. And yeah.
Kind of effects into the use and how long the.
That's a good question. Very good question. Thank you. In this evaluation, we used 100 sentences selected to reflect kind of our usage. So half of them, or a little bit less than half, were originating from driveabout. So they were kind of in-domain, semi-in-domain, I will call them. And the rest of them were like web answers and stuff that was coming from the logs. So they were, I would say, 50% in-domain, 50% out-of-domain, or something like this. Now we use 900 utterances for valuations. So what still 100 utterances with seven or eight samples per utterance is pretty much a very, very big test to run. It's much bigger than people do in other cases.
The average duration of
the samples? The average duration is between 1 second and three. It effectively corresponds to our usage, the way we, the way people use the Google TDS.
And the mix, you mentioned mix excitation on border.
Yes.
Using the straight information on analysis.
Using a straight like.
Straight parameters extracted in the analysis.
Yes.
Which, how many bands operated?
Seven bands. For the 22 kilohertz signal. So it's a typical standard MELCAP based mixed band excitation with the filter that Tokuda made for MELCAP.
Huh? And the straight band.
Yes, yes, yes. These bands are actually not from Crete. They come from the paper of from mixed band excitation vocoder paper of Alan McCree. They're exactly the same. Yes. And if you go to, okay, this is what happens in European languages, but if you go to Asian languages, we have a much better improvement, mainly because we don't understand the Asian languages. Now we have more people from China, and we have much better representation. So we're doing better. But when this test was running, it was a clear benefit of the parametric system over the new selection. So what I would conclude out of this is that if you can spend a lot of money to make your unit selection system sound good, that's great. If you cannot spend a lot of money to do this, then the LSTM may actually be better for a reduced, slightly smaller amount of data as well. So, results and discussion, and here are the papers. I'm already 5 minutes late, so I will pick up questions for 5 or 10 minutes and then we can go. Yes? Anyone?
You started out in your description of Vocaine,
yeah,
saying that it was universal in the sense that it was compatible with straight. And so forth.
Yes, it is, indeed.
And then in what followed, mm-hmm, I kind of lost track of what you presented afterwards in terms of whether it corresponds to a different model or a different implementation that one could plug straight into.
Okay. So, straight here, you see, you have used the analysis and we use Vocaine for synthesis. As at the beginning, Vocaine is the part that does the generation of the waveform. It is not the part that does the analysis. Think of it, for example, in MP3 implementations of the algorithm, the MP3 standard tells you, this is how I'm doing synthesis. You can do whatever you want in the analysis as long as your bitstream has these specifications. This is exactly what Vocaine is, in a way. It's the thing that takes you from the parameters to the actual signal. So it is both state compatible, it is H&M compatible, it is AQHM compatible. You can use whatever model you want.
What about this part with the pair of quadratic splines that were...
That part was about how to generate the signal once you have two endpoints, and in these endpoints, you know the phases. So that's a very simple question. I'm giving you the phases in this part of the signal, in that part of the signal, the amplitudes in this part of the signal, and that part, we're talking about instantaneous phase averages because I give them for one particular time instant, and I want you to synthesize something. What you would say would be, let's do an overlap add, right? That's not the best you can do. Assuming stationarity and overlap adding, yes.
And so the thing is going to do this regardless of whether you get it straight or not.
Exactly, yeah. It has already. Coder is not straight. It's something that produces some sort of parameters that are straight-like. It has an aperiodicity in bands, and it has an amplitude, a spectral envelope. But as long as it gives you the parameters, then you can do whatever it is.
Could you elaborate a bit more on how you get the phase estimate and assume that they have just like the magnitude spectrum?
Yes. So that's a good question. So a very good question. I will have to write this down. I should be keeping this, actually. Yes. So we have two components there, right? Every phase. It has a deterministic component plus another component that depends on a periodicity. Right? Let's put this as a function or something. It's a function of the aperiodicity. This is the deterministic part of the phase. This is the stochastic part of the phase. The deterministic part, I use minimum phase. You can extract it using minimum phase assumption from the log spectral envelope. I use maximum phase, the complete reverse. I used a mixed phase, but I ended up using this very simple way. I fill up a vector with random values between minus pi uniform distribution minus pi comma pi. And then this is the phase that goes always to the first harmonic. This is the phase that goes always to the second harmonic. This is the phase that goes always to the, let's say, 200th harmonic if there is one ever. So as you change harmonics, as you have different pitch periods, right, and different pitch, you will pick up a different phase. If your signal is stationary, this is completely fixed. If your signal changes, this phase changes almost randomly in a way. So if you have a big change, you will get a big change as well. And this is like assuming that it's a fixed envelope per F0. But this is the cheapest way I could get ever to put in a phase. Because as you remember, the Vocaine takes three, has to work in these devices here, right? And this device have, and also has to work, not only this, it's a high-end device, has to work to a billion devices. So it has to be extremely fast. So effectively, I threw away every sort of minimum phase assumptions, any sort of phase assumptions, and put that because that's much faster. But, and audibly, if you hear it, you can't tell a difference. And I have this sample, I never presented to any publication, so, but you can't hear a difference between minimum phase and this one, but you can hear a difference only in maximum phase, only on the voice tone sets. Why? Because in maximum phase, let's say in a periodic speech, there's no difference at all between minimum phase and maximum phase, which is weird because minimum phase goes like this, and maximum phase does the exact opposite. Maximum phase goes like this. So there's no audible difference. But in voice tone sets, it does matter. Because in voice tone sets goes something like this. That's it. And then here, you have somehow the voice tone set. If I synthesize with maximum phase, then the energy goes here, goes before the voice tone set. So it changes your perception of, it is like pre-echo in a way, right? So you don't want that. So there are sometimes audible puffs. But from this part on, it's okay. Which brings a little bit the question, up above what quality do we need phase and for what reason? I have very good examples about that effectively telling that phase is not the primary problem. I'm not worried about this one. I'm not worried about phase. I'm worried about phase when I have to glue it together with a normal waveforms. Yes, there I'm worried mostly about linear phase. But I'm not worried about phase when it has to do the waveform modeling itself. I hope I answered the question. And
do you have any audio examples?
You can open up your mobile. And I can play you something. I had a demo here. From time to time, you know, whenever you're trying to do without practicing it, it may not work. So you will excuse me in that case. I will put, hopefully. Ah, sorry. Yes. Synthesis value again. Okay, hello world. Ah, okay, I found it. Give me a second. Mm-hmm. Okay, it keeps failing. Well, as demos happen, I had to prepare that. But your mobile is actually used. If you have the latest Android, you can put any synthesis, put local only or disconnect, put it in airplane mode, and you will hear the LSTM, or back in LSTM. For copy, eh? iPhone. Yes, I mean Google Now and iPhone. Well, we do the Google Now, but we don't do it for iPhone because it's a different company. Okay, so Google Now uses the unit selection system when you're connected. So if you put in airplane mode, you will force it to use the embedded one. Yes.
Can researchers outside of Google use Vocaine?
Of course not. you know how the patent law works. You can copy any patent you want, any at all, right? As long as you don't put it in a product. So you can implement it yourself. There's a bunch of things I haven't told you because how much can I tell you in 30 publications, 30 pages, right? But you cannot use it without violating the primary claims. I am always pro open sourcing, and I will open source a new vocoder straight like yet another vocoder from that Hideki made when he was in our lab and he was working with me and Heger pretty soon. So this will happen in due time. So we'll open source, but we will not open source Vocaine because it is hard to implement. So it gives a kind of an edge there. Because it's very fast. That's the main thing, I think. You may be able to copy the quality, maybe, but the speed at this quality is a hard thing to do. Yes. Other questions?
Just to make sure my understanding is correct.
Yes.
So earlier you put that phase equation, you extract the actual phase as the sum of the local track properties and noise properties?
That's a very good question. It breaks down. It's not a source filter. It is not a source filter vocoder, right?
I see. So for the kind of noise part, so did you find, is it the case that you find kind of correlation between the noise, the APR density with the phase derivation made of the difference?
No. If your this is multiplied, if you remember the equation, by a random number, right? So you will not have any correlation because you put a random number here. And the answer, going in the wrong direction. You have a random number here. It's a uniform. That goes from minus a function of a periodicity P4 to plus. So it's always random. So you will have no correlation because of that. It's actually this bit here.
So you already randomized the phase. Why you're trying to interpolate that?
Because I don't want to use overlap and add. I do not want to use overlap add as a way to have somehow to reconstruct a waveform between two parts, right? I don't want to use overlap add.
Mean that if you actually use overlap add, then you actually have to interpolate that.
If you use overlap add, you are having an implicit assumption about how overlap add or how the interpolation is made, right? And but the problem with overlap add is what happens when you have two different, quite different frequencies. You have, let's say, 100 hertz, 140 hertz. We can deal with these differences. With the Vocaine, there's no problem. You can have some. But, so that's the idea of interpolating rather than doing overlap add with stationarity assumptions. The other thing that happens with overlap add is that the higher frequencies, in overlap add, you make some assumptions, right? You make some assumptions that, the pitch period represents your pitch. That's true if your F0 gives you an integer pitch period. But if it doesn't, if there's small deviations there, then the overlap process has two main disadvantages. One is that it dampens the higher frequencies because it introduces random fluctuations that have of the sinusoidal components that have a destructive relationship in the higher frequencies. One sample, half a sample difference in 1 kilohertz is nothing. Half a sample difference in 8 kilohertz is a really huge amount. And that introduces a dampening of the third format, the fourth format. It sounds like a less vivid speech. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that if you try to synthesize noise with overlap art, the noise has the mean that you expect, but the variance fluctuates with your synthesis window. So the variance of the noise is reduced whenever you sample two noise samples, right? You have epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2. It has less variance than epsilon, right? Because if all these follow the same distribution. Because you reduce the variance here, you sum stuff, which means in overlap art, here in the middle, you summed up a noise here and a noise there, and then but your variance of the noise goes lower, so you have a fluctuation of variance, and I don't want to have this. And in high quality, some high quality methods that they were actually in audio, they were trying to minimize this with special widths and so on. I didn't directly in the frequency domain.
Like proof advantage of your
base
interpolation method over the previous
cubic interpolation? Well, unless you're asking about experiments, right? No, I've used the cubic interpolation method quite a lot, and then it had random glitches because sometimes it was not. For example, you can control. The short answer is there's no formal experiment for this. You can control whether it goes like this. You can control whether the most of the change, that's what I was saying, the derivative, let's say, of your curve here, where the most of the amplitude, this, let's say this is your criterion here, right? Second derivative of this. Then, and this is from, you can, that it's evenly distributed. If you would like to have a maximum difference, because when you have a difference from here to there, you have to distribute it somehow within the glottal cycle. And when you would like to distribute your difference in order to do the transition from this phase to that phase, you would like to have a couple of properties. The property I want to have was to break harmonicity as much as possible. This doesn't explicitly break harmonicity for me. So if you try to synthesize noise with this, occasionally you may get glitches or you may not get the thing that, you may not get a clean noise without a pitch and so on. And that's why, but this one, this guy here, allows you to do this because it goes and puts it straight in the middle. So it breaks harmonicity very efficiently. Also, this model has an extra parameter, and when you're counting every computation in order to fit it to the specifications, then having a model for less complexity is a much desirable thing to have.
Your method is more robust and expensive.
Yes. We're done, thank you. I think we're already way past 4. Thank you very much.